Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for the first event in our 2021 Dean Seminar Series, To Race with the World, John Henryism and the Health of Black Americans. Our speaker today is Dr. Sherman James, and if you do have questions, we'll be taking those at the end. We'll be sharing a URL to submit your questions, so please feel free to submit them throughout the event. And with that, I turn it back to Dr. Jermaine Lewis.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our Spring Dean Seminar Series. We're a little bit late getting started, trying to give everybody a chance to get back into the spring semester during what we hope is a declining COVID season. But the wait is well worth it because I'm incredibly proud and excited to have Professor Sherman James as our kickoff seminar series speaker for this spring. You're really in for a treat, and I want to take a little bit of time to tell you about this incredible speaker. While he is well known to many of us and throughout the world, I suspect there may be a few of you who are not completely familiar with his work. He has been a lifelong researcher in the field of health disparities, in particular, looking at the health disparities for African Americans in this country, long before others jumped on the bandwagon. When looking at his career, you will see and hear his leadership abilities, his outstanding research and advocacy work. A social epidemiologist long before it became popular. Popularity has really grown in the last several years, which is a good thing. His expertise in the social determinants of racial and ethnic health disparities has been known to many. You're going to hear about his John Henryism hypothesis, so I'm not going to say anything more, but I can certainly remember graduate school and learning about it, and the ability now to hear directly from the author about his hypothesis that generated the John Henryism scale for active coping. And maybe he'll tell you a little more about that as well. I have been a reader of Professor James' work for a long time, and I can assure you that he has worked tirelessly to promote empirical research focusing on health disparities and their solutions. And bringing those discoveries to the classroom and then bringing them to the professions that he has served has really been instrumental in my own career in thinking about impact. It's great to be a researcher, it's great to be a teacher, it's great to serve, but to do all three and to do them so well is truly a remarkable accomplishment. I believe that Professor James embodies what is needed to be a true scholar from academe to community and back. Currently, he is the Susan B. King Emeritus Professor of Public Policy in the Sanford School of Public Policy at Duke University, and also a core member of the Center for Biobehavioral Health Disparities Social Science Research Institute at Duke. He's had many faculty positions in Duke in sociology, community and family health, public health, and African American studies. And I think those multiple positions just underscore the relevancy of the work for so many different disciplines. Prior to his recruitment at Duke, Professor James was on faculty at the University of Michigan, preceded by a 16-year career at UNC. And I think it's particularly noteworthy that he was the first African-American faculty member in the School of Public Health at UNC. While on at Michigan, he had a long-standing career as the John P. Kirsch Collegiate Professor of Public Health. He was the founding director of the Center for Research on Ethnicity, Culture, and Health. He chaired the Department of Health Behavior and Health Education, and he was a senior research scientist at the famed ISR at Michigan. He has a long list of awards in research, teaching and service, and really underscoring that tripart aspect of his career as a scholar. He's an elected member of what was formerly the IOM and now the National Academies of Science. He's received the top awards from the American Public Health Association, such as the Abraham Lilienfeld, the Wade Hampton Frost. Some of the top career accomplishment awards from the Society for Epidemiologic Research, such as the Ken Rothman Award for career accomplishments. And he's the elected fellow of the American Epidemiologic Society, the American College of Epidemiology, the American Heart Association, the Academy of Behavioral Medicine Research, the American Academy of Political and Social Sciences. Again, metrics that speak to the relevancy of his work for many audiences. This is in addition to a long-standing distinguished lectureships that he's given at all different places and institutions, and I hope you'll add Mason to your long list. And just wanted to emphasize the teaching awards as well, being recognized as a distinguished teaching faculty, the top 5% at Duke, as well as being bestowed the Abraham Lilienfeld Teaching Award from the American Public Health Association. He was the past president of the Society for Epidemiologic Research, and he currently serves on the governing board for the American Academy of Political and Social Sciences. These accomplishments were made possible by his earned doctoral degree in social psychology from the Washington University, which was preceded by an appointment as second lieutenant in the Air Force, something I did not know prior to taking a look. So please join me in giving a virtual welcome to Professor James. Thank you.
Well, thank you so very much for that really terrific introduction, and I'm delighted to be a part of the Dean's Seminar Series. Dean Lewis, it's an honor. My only regret is that I can't be there in person. I'd love to see your campus and have a chance to interact with the faculty and students any one day. I've been working on the concept of John Henryism and engaged in empirical research on the John Henryism hypothesis for a good many years. And you might think that I now know everything there is to know about John Henryism, but I assure you, I do not. But I have reached some preliminary conclusions, conclusions based on my own research and on that of others. And I'll be sharing some of those conclusions with you today. And of course it will be up to, you know, to others, perhaps some of you who are tuned in today to determine what I got right and where I missed the boat. So let's begin. I'm first of all going to share with you a figure from the 1977 issue of the American Journal of Epidemiology entitled Race, Education, and Prevalence of Hypertension. And this particular figure summarizes the distribution of, I'm going to say, pre-existing hypertension, defined as a diastolic blood pressure of 95 millimeters of mercury or greater, or currently taking antihypertensive drugs, generated by the screening of 159,000 people to determine their eligibility in the NIH multi-centered trial, very large trial, funded by the NIH to test the efficacy of drug treatment for what was then called mild hypertension being defined as a resting diastolic blood pressure between 90 and 94 millimeters of mercury. They didn't know at the time if treating mild hypertension would be efficacious in preventing heart attacks and strokes. So they wanted to conduct a five-year field study to answer that question. So this particular slide shows the distribution of hypertension, as I mentioned a moment ago, by race, black or white, and by level of education, ranging from a low of 10 years of formal schooling to a high of college graduate. And two things stand out on this slide. One is a stepwise decrease in the prevalence of hypertension for both blacks and whites, but particularly for whites, because you can see a leveling off of the prevalence of hypertension for blacks when you get to some college and college graduate, and there's a continuous decline in the prevalence among whites as you go from high school, some college, college graduate. The other thing that stands out is the 1.5 to 2-fold excess prevalence of hypertension for Black Americans at just about every level of education, which raised the still hotly debated question as to whether or not the well-known excess prevalence of hypertension among Black Americans has its origins primarily in genetic factors or environmental factors. Now, I had been on the faculty at UNC Chapel Hill for about, really a few months when a senior colleague showed me this, actually 4 years, when a senior colleague showed me this particular slide. And this was the figure that basically launched my investigation of John Henryism. It provides the epidemiological context for just about all of my work testing the John Henryism hypothesis, which I will describe in more detail momentarily. Well, the five-year field trial by the NIH was remarkably successful. It turned out that treating so-called mild hypertension was very effective in reducing stroke and heart disease death rates in both blacks and whites, but particularly in blacks. And so NIH decided to issue a call for grant applications to implement high blood pressure control programs in rural and urban communities all across the country. And senior colleagues in the epidemiology department at Chapel Hill invited me to join them in writing and then conducting a study designed to improve high blood pressure control in a rural community in eastern North Carolina, a part of the state of North Carolina, indeed a part of the Southeast United States, well known for very high mortality rates from heart disease and stroke, particularly stroke mortality in the Black population. So we wanted to go to an area where we knew that there would be a great need for the kind of intervention work that we wanted to do. And we decided further that we wanted to focus on Black men, a group that was at especially high risk of developing high blood pressure fairly early in adulthood and not being under medical care for the disorder and the health problems that resulted from uncontrolled hypertension. And so we wanted to reach out to Black men. And we decided to make that a special focus of the grant application, but we didn't have any good ideas about how to do that. So I volunteered to interview some Black men with high blood pressure, and one of our collaborating physician investigators who's actively involved in treating patients with high blood pressure and other health problems, arranged for me to interview five of his black male hypertensive patients. And the very first man that I met and interviewed was named John Henry Martin. And this was in July of 1978. Well, this slide shows John Henry Martin on the right and me on the left. I was 34 years of age at the time. And he lived, he was a retired farmer, and he lived in a rural community about 35 or 40 miles north of Chapel Hill. And I didn't know his full name when we first started talking. All I knew was his name was John Martin. And I didn't have a script, you know, of questions to guide the interview. It was pretty much open-ended, but because he was retired, he had time on his hand. In his hands, he began to tell me his life story. And it was a truly remarkable life story. He was born into an illiterate, sharecropping family, dirt poor, in 1907. And his parents were sharecroppers. His grandparents were also sharecroppers. And of course, many of you will perhaps know that sharecropping was a very, very exploitive system of labor, whereby sharecroppers, most of whom were black, most of whom were illiterate or at the most semi-illiterate, produced crops, cotton and tobacco, on land owned by wealthy whites. And they were supposed to receive half of the income generated from the sale of the crops. Well, more often than not, they did not receive half. The landowners were often very clever, finding ways to cheat them out of their half, and it was a way of keeping them impoverished and having to continue working from year to year on their farms. So that was the kind of family that John Henry Martin was born into. And as he came of age, he vowed that he would not have the kind of future that his father had, working for halves, as he called it, you know, and then not having anything to show for it at the end of every year. And so he did set out in his probably late 20s, early 30s, after he had gotten married, to purchase some land. It turned out to be 75 acres of land. And that was the story that he told me, that he worked night and day to pay off a mortgage that he received from the bank. He had 40 years to do it, and he wanted to pay it off in 1 year, but he managed to pay it off actually in 5 years, which was really a remarkable achievement. Now, he had high blood pressure, and during the course of our conversation, I mostly listened, he did most of the talking, I learned that he had also suffered from peptic ulcers, a case of peptic ulcers so severe that it required 40% of his stomach to be removed. And you can see the cane in his right hand, he could barely walk. And that was because he was suffering from a debilitating case of osteoarthritis, which forced him to retire from farming long before he was ready to do so. And so in recent years, I became increasingly interested in trying to understand the concept of John Henryism, which I will describe in some detail in a moment, trying to understand the concept of John Henryism not only as a kind of a psychological phenomenon or a behavioral disposition, but I wanted to understand its historical and cultural underpinnings. The question is, where did it come from? Why was it such a widespread phenomenon among Black Americans, the Black Americans that you know, whom I studied in all of my research, and the Black Americans who other people were studying? So that got me exploring American history. And the experiences of Black Americans coming out of slavery, moving through the Reconstruction period, through the end of the 19th century into the early years of the 20th century, at a time when the former white Confederates had basically regained political control of the southern states, and white supremacy had been firmly established, reestablished across the South. Well, we could have no better guide as to what the world looked like for Black Americans at the dawn of the 20th century than the great historian sociologist W.B. Du Bois and his classic 1903 book, The Souls of Black Folk. And shown here is probably the most famous line in that book. The problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. But what did that really mean in detail? Well, in 1896, the Supreme Court ruled in Plessy versus Ferguson that racial segregation was legal as long as it was equal. So the famous separate but equal Supreme Court decision, not overturned until 1954 with the Brown v. Board of Education decision by the Warren Supreme Court. So you can see from just those two dates, we're talking about, you know, almost a 60-year period of time of legal, racial, and unequal segregation. Widespread Black voter suppression campaigns began all across the South in the 1890s. The use of poll taxes because most of the Blacks were poor, they could not afford to pay poll taxes, the infamous literacy tests, because again, most of the Blacks in the South could not read, certainly could not interpret complicated passages from the Constitution. And of course, if these tactics did not work to keep Blacks away from the polls, then you had domestic terrorism enacted by the KKK. And this was also a period of time when negative anti-Black stereotypes were very pervasive in the media and entertainment. And these pervasive negative stereotypes, you know, were a form of cultural racism. If Plessy v. Ferguson and Black voter suppression were forms of structural racism, because we're talking about laws that constrain the freedom of movement and the freedom of expression of Black folks, then these negative stereotypes were a form of cultural racism, just denigrating the humanity of Black people. And the Confederate monuments, which were also constructed all across the South, and those of you in Virginia are very familiar, obviously, with this particular issue. Most of the Confederate monuments were constructed between 1900 and 1910. Again, an expression of cultural racism, symbolically letting Black folks know who's in charge and what their place in the society was. And then, of course, the ongoing labor exploitation one important example of which was the sharecropper system, the system into which John Henry Martin was born. Another example, of course, was convict labor, the convict lease system, where sort of the earliest form of mass incarceration whereby Black folks, not just Black men, but Black women, were thrown into prison on trumped up charges, petty larceny and burglary and so on, and given long prison sentences, and then leased out to corporations to work on railroads or to work in the mines as the South began to industrialize. So the cheap labor supplied by Black convicts, mostly Black men, but not exclusively Black men, Black women as well. So these were the kinds of themes. You know, this was sort of the political culture, the economic circumstance, the cultural environment that prevailed at the dawn of the 20th century. This was the world that John Henry Martin was born into and that shaped his worldview and that constrained his life chances and the life chances of millions of other Black Americans, 90% of whom lived in the South at this time. So this is what they were up against. And the great historian, Leon Lidwack, wrote this about the Jim Crow laws, as we sort of referred to them in a large sense. They made no exception based on social class or education. Didn't matter whether you had a college degree, a PhD, an MD, or illiterate. What the White South insisted on was not so much separation of the races as subordination. So Du Bois wrote near the end of the opening essay of The Souls of Black Folk, the essay entitled Of Our Spiritual Strivings, he wrote this: a people thus handicapped ought not to be asked to race with the world. The personal disrespect, ridicule, distortion of facts, cynical ignoring of the better, and boisterous welcoming of the worse, you know, the cultural racism he's making a reference to. Before this, there arises a sickening despair that would disarm and discourage any nation save the Black host to whom discouragement is an unwritten word. So even in the face of all of this, he is writing, he is observing. He's at Atlanta University now, teaching in the sociology department, latter part of the 19th century, early part of the 20th century. And he is saying the Black masses were not discouraged, even though they were faced with all of these forces of dehumanization, subjugation, and exploitation. And this is what I took away from my meeting with John Henry Martin. He was not discouraged. He refused to give in. He refused to give up. He refused to be subordinated by this system, this labor system of economic exploitation. And he was determined to overcome it, even though in the process of doing so, he paid a price with his health because he pushed himself so very hard. And I think with this background, this infuses, at least for me, the legend of John Henry, the steel driving man, with a very different meaning than what is conventionally understood. Here's one short stanza from a work song celebrating the legendary feat by John Henry, the steel driving man. The steam drill was on the right-hand side, John Henry was on the left. Says, before I let this steam drill beat me down, I'll hammer myself to death. I'll hammer myself to death. So John Henry, who was probably, the legendary John Henry, was probably a convict laborer, working on the railroads, tunneling, helping to tunnel through mines in the early 1870s. was challenged by his white supervisor to compete, to engage in an epic steel driving contest against a newly invented machine. John Henry, the legendary John Henry, knew what was at stake, and he engaged in the challenge. He beat the machine, but he dropped dead immediately after his victory from complete exhaustion. So he has been celebrated by working men. It turns out working white men as well as working black men throughout the ages for his refusal to be defeated by a machine. And so he is one of the very few black folks who has had widespread appeal across racial and social class lines throughout the ages, but very few people know that he was probably a convict laborer. So here are some quotes from my interview with John Henry Martin, which I wrote up in the inaugural issue of Southern Cultures, a UNC/Duke University publication, back in 1993. So John Henry Martin said to me at one point, so I kept thinking about it, and I was regular working for the white man and wasn't getting but half of my labor. I just didn't like it. I had 40 years to pay for it, the mortgage, but I worked night and day and paid it off in 5 years. Oh yeah, that's my trouble. I work too hard. And so I already told you that not only did he have high blood pressure, but he had had a very serious case of peptic ulcers, and he was suffering from debilitating osteoarthritis, all of which happened to him by the time he was in his early 60s. And of course, he'd probably had high blood pressure for decades before it was diagnosed. Well, shortly after my encounter with John Henry Martin, I began to think about this and began to ponder the question, was his life story emblematic of the life story of Black Americans writ large? And as he told me his life story, I began to think about my my parents, my aunts and my uncles, many of the other working class Black folks who raised me as a boy. I grew up in a Southern working class family. And so many of these folks had high blood pressure. And so many of them, you know, had just worked extremely hard all of their lives trying to make a way out of no way, trying to make things a little bit better for the next generation. And that's what John Henry Martin was trying to do. And so I came to believe that John Henry Martin's life story was not only an echo of the legend of John Henry, the steel driving man, but it was really emblematic of the Black American struggle. It was emblematic of the Black American experience. And I began to ponder if that might be one of the reasons why there is so much high blood pressure, heart disease, strokes in Black Americans, particularly working class Black Americans, particularly Black Americans who are not particularly well educated. So it planted the seeds of what I came to call the John Henryism hypothesis. He was, on this slide is shown the conceptual definition of John Henryism. It's a strong predisposition to confront adversity with determined high effort coping. Now for Black Americans, adversity is represented most strikingly by intergenerational economic hardship caused by laws, regulations, social norms, and institutional practices that limit meaningful social and economic advancement, structural racism, systemic racism. And when we think about systemic racism, we think about it its economic dimensions, the way it plays out economically, and cultural racism, the way it plays out culturally, to demean people, to not give them the respect that they are entitled to as fellow human beings. So it's a very pervasive kind of phenomenon. The John Henryism hypothesis then posits that repeated high effort coping with adversity accelerates physiological wear and tear, and it results in an earlier onset of cardiovascular diseases. Now, the hypothesis has its roots not only, you know, in folklore and in my encounter with John Henry Martin, but also in some very impressive scientific research, laboratory research, field research, conducted primarily in the 1970s, because I began to read, you know, about high effort coping and how the sympathetic nervous system, you know, responds when people are challenged with a task to resolve. And as long as they believe that they can resolve it and they work hard to do so, you see this sort of cascade of sympathetic nervous system phenomena, including increased blood pressure, particularly systolic blood pressure, and so on. And then, of course, Bruce McEwen's work on allelic steady load really advanced our thinking about the kinds of about how chronic stress can accelerate physiological wear and tear, resulting in earlier onset of cardiovascular diseases. And Harlan Geronimus's concept of weathering is another important resource that deepened my thinking about the plausibility of the John Henryism hypothesis. And in terms of the biological mechanisms that perhaps that putatively connect repeated high effort coping with accelerated wear and tear and an earlier onset of cardiovascular disease, you know, increased heart rate, increased blood pressure, stress hormone, cortisol, glucose, lipids, inflammation, blood vessel wall thickening, you know, that whole sort of process that results in a remodeling of the cardiovascular system and the early onset of heart attacks and end stage renal disease. Again, something which predominantly affects African Americans more so than any other group in the United States. We don't really know for sure when racial differences, black-white differences in hypertension, for example, occur. That is to say, how early in life, but the best source of, probably the best source of data on that question, you know, when do racial differences in blood pressure first appear? Probably the best source of data on that is the Bogalusa, Louisiana Heart Study, which has been following Black folks for 40 years or so. And this particular slide shows growth trajectories in systolic and diastolic blood pressure, systolic on the left, diastolic on the right, for males, black and white, and females, black and white. And you see there are really no racial differences in terms of resting systolic blood pressure or diastolic blood pressure prior to maybe 14, 15 years of age. And then you see in the solid black line, black males begin to separate themselves from other groups, and then black women coming along a little bit later. The racial differences are more striking, a little clearer for systolic blood pressure than for diastolic blood pressure. So nothing really remarkable until maybe mid-adolescence, and then by the early 20s, you see black males in particular separating themselves from the other groups. Okay, so that's a bit of the background. What is John Henryism? I've given a conceptual definition of it, repeated high effort coping with adversity. How is it measured? So I developed the John Henryism Active Coping Scale. It's a 12-item scale. JAC-12 is how I refer to it. Here are four sample questions from the 12 items. Now I want you to listen to the underlying themes of tenacity and determination and optimism and belief in yourself, because that's really what I was trying to get at, just the refusal to give up, the refusal to be subjected, to be controlled. I've always felt that I could make of my life pretty much what I wanted to make of it. When things don't go the way I want them to, that just makes me work even harder. It's not always easy, but I usually find a way to do the things I really need to get done. Hard work has really helped me to get ahead in life. And each of the 12 items can be scored on a 5-point Likert scale. Score five if the person says completely true, score of one if the person says completely false. So given that there are 12 items, the highest score that you can make is 60, the lowest score is 12. Well, guess what? The median score for Black Americans in my studies typically is 53. And it's sort of like that, you know, maybe depending on whether or not the don't know category is included. If it's excluded, then the highest score that one can make is 48. But in studies conducted by other people, where sometimes they have excluded the don't know category, once again, you see scores for Black Americans skew toward the higher values. So there's something, the scale does sort of tap into something that is deeply cultural for Black Americans. And I think if we can understand, we can understand the historical and the cultural significance of these responses when we reflect on the structural and cultural racism that Black Americans were faced with as the 20th century got underway. The same forces of systemic racism that basically stayed in place for 2/3 of the 20th century. Here's what we know about the correlates of John Henryism, high John Henryism. People who score low in education tend to score higher. People with blue-collar jobs tend to score higher. I've already mentioned that African-Americans tend to score higher. And in terms of psychosocial correlates, and this is really important because there's nothing sort of inherently pathological or psychopathological about John Henryism. In fact, just the opposite. People who score high in John Henryism tend to report higher levels of self-rated health. They tend to report, you know, that they're not overly stressed. They tend to have good social relationships. The literature is a little bit mixed on this depression thing, but most studies show that high scores on John Henryism are associated with low risk for depression, which to me makes good sense. High scores tend not to abuse substances, alcohol, drugs, and so on. They're very conscientious people. They're very hard workers, have a lot of energy, and they have self-control, and they reflect. If something happens, they sort of reflect before they respond. So the overall psychosocial profile is really, from my point of view, pretty healthy. So here's a more recent summary of the prevalence of hypertension by race and ethnicity. This is for adults age 20 and higher. And you can see on this slide that Black adults tend to be 50 to 75% higher at higher risk for being hypertensive than whites and Hispanics. They really do stand out from the other racial groups. And the fact that there's so much high blood pressure in the Black American community is the major reason why the heart disease death rate, stroke death rates are as high as they are. And because African Americans tend to score higher than other groups, and working class Black Americans and less well-educated Black Americans tend to score the highest, then it raises the question, is it the case that because so many less well-educated and working class Blacks score high on John Henryism, is that one of the reasons why there's so much more high blood pressure among less well-educated and working class Blacks here? is it the subgroup of high John Henryism Black folks, of whom there are many in the country, is that the subgroup that's really pushing up this high prevalence of hypertension among the less well educated? That's the question. So the John Henryism hypothesis then is really an interaction. It asks the question, do high scores on John Henryism in combination with impoverished socioeconomic conditions predict a higher risk, let's just say of high blood pressure, although we could expand that and talk about cardiovascular disease, cardiometabolic disease risk more generally. So that there are two ways of looking at the interaction. So two views of theoretical expectations. The first one is this, where the idea is that the inverse gradient between socioeconomic disadvantage and cardiovascular disease risk is stronger for persons scoring high on John Henryism when John Henryism is dichotomized into high or low compared to those who score low. So the interaction, you see how the lines cross there. So that's one way of sort of graphically portraying the hypothesized interaction. When John Henryism is scored as a continuous measure and you can standardize the scores, then the hypothesis suggests that at low levels of John Henryism, let's say minus one standard deviation below the mean, you don't see much of a difference in terms of risk cardiovascular disease as a function of level of socioeconomic disadvantage. But it is at the higher levels, when you have one standard deviation or higher in John Henryism, that's where you see the social gradient being expressed. Now, we don't know exactly when this gradient first emerges. Can you see it in childhood or only in adulthood? And what about when you take into account the kinds of neighborhood conditions in which African Americans live? And of course, you know that in urban environments with racial residential segregation, a lot of the neighborhoods that African Americans live in, particularly working class African Americans, are fraught with all kinds of challenges, all kinds of chronic stressors. And these neighborhood level stressors could impact their risk for hypertension above and beyond what their individual SCS characteristics are, above and beyond their level of education, above and beyond their income levels and so on. So as the work moves from rural environments into more urban environments, it may become increasingly important to take into account the kinds of neighborhoods that Black folks live in and then model those neighborhood conditions via multi-level modeling in an appropriate way. Okay, I have to be attentive now to the findings, and so I'm going to go through these very quickly and try to get through everything else in maybe 5 minutes. Leave a little bit of time for questions. Okay, so very quickly, the John Henryism hypothesis, just as I have described it, has been tested in European populations, and the results, at least from these two studies that I showed you, which I won't discuss, suggests that there is supportive evidence in non-Black American populations. I've never maintained that this is a Black-specific construct. I think it really taps into the human conditions and may help us to understand something about the social class gradient in cardiovascular disease risk in Western populations more generally. So I began my work in the early 1980s with sort of my own first tests of the John Henryism hypothesis, largely in Eastern North Carolina in rural and semi-urban communities, did that work in the 1980s into the early 1990s. Others began to then pick up on the hypothesis. They tested in mid-sized cities outside of North Carolina in the mid-2000s. And some investigators in large multi-ethnic cities in the upper Midwest tested the hypothesis. And then we have a couple of studies that looked at the question of how early do we see evidence of the interaction you know, see it in children, do we see it in adolescents? And that work has been done in rural and mid-sized cities in Georgia. So again, theoretical expectations, that's what we're looking for. The question is, to what degree do the empirical findings from these various studies reproduce that picture? Very quickly, here's a summary of the trajectory research findings from community-based studies. My own work early on in the 1980s, we found pretty good evidence of support for the hypothesis, building increasingly larger sample sizes. Even though we start out with males, turns out that the hypothesis holds up for both Black men and for Black women. The issue of what's going on with white Americans in the South is a topic for another day, perhaps. And then going outside of Eastern North Carolina, mid-sized cities, elsewhere, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, nice study. Did not find evidence for the interaction, but found evidence for a John Henryism main effect on systolic and diastolic blood pressure. Cardia, big study, no. That's another story, we can talk about that perhaps. Jackson Heart study, mixed results. Now to the larger, multi-ethnic, metropolitan upper Midwest. Nice study conducted in Detroit that looked at Blacks, whites, and Latinx folks, published in Ethnicity and Disease. Mean blood pressure was the outcome. Did not find evidence for the interaction, but did find evidence for John Henryism main effect on systolic blood pressure that applied to Blacks, whites, and Latinx. And I think a reasonable explanation for why we didn't see the interaction is because this was inner city Detroit. Very few individuals of any race or ethnicity who were college graduates, who had high levels of income, white collar jobs. And so you had a truncated distribution for the SCS variables, which really constrained the ability to detect an interaction. But what came through was the main effect for John Henryism, and it applied across all groups. And then there was this really interesting study in Chicago, published several years ago, again, tri-ethnic, looking at the prevalence of hypertension and obesity. But now they took into account not just individual level attributes, but the neighborhood conditions. So it was a multi-level test of the John Henryism hypothesis. And I'll skip this because it just indicates, you know, the kinds of census level data that they use to characterize neighborhood level conditions, so for their modeling purposes. Here are the results from the Chicago study. Here they use John Henryism scaled as a continuous variable. And we can see that in terms of predicting the prevalence of hypertension at low levels of John Henryism, minus one standard deviation below the mean, not much of an effect for neighborhood level disadvantage. But then when you get to the higher level, one standard deviation above the mean, you see the predicted result. This is for hypertension. This is for BMI. For obesity, you see exactly the same pattern for obesity. So then it's important, you know, to when you think about, you know, how to measure socioeconomic disadvantage, think about the ecological setting in which the study population is embedded. Be sensitive to the various factors that actually might impact or might determine how much access people have to socioeconomic resources that will enable them to live in a healthy way without wearing themselves out in the process. So there have been a couple of studies on children and adolescents, and without belaboring the point, it turns out that yes, you get that interaction. So the phenomenon, the John Henryism hypothesis appears, the effects appear to begin fairly early in life. It's not an adult specific phenomenon, at least based on these two studies, which were really very well done studies. There's the interaction from the study of children who were between ages 10 and 17. And this is the one I'm looking at, metabolic syndrome, another important you know, health outcome to look at. Again, you see that crossover effect, it mimics the expected results. So concluding, future research needs, we need more longitudinal studies, we need harder clinical outcomes going beyond blood pressure, going beyond metabolic syndrome, looking at heart attacks, and I'm talking about the Black population, looking at heart attacks in Blacks. We saw it in Finland. We need to test the hypothesis against some hard clinical outcomes in Black Americans. We need more studies on children and adolescents, because think about the prevention implications of this, right? If this is something that starts very early in life, then we're talking about poor Black kids who want to make something of themselves, much like John Henry Martin, who want to make something of themselves and who are studying hard and working hard and pushing themselves. They may be doing just fine from a psychological point of view, but what is happening at the physiological level? Are they on a much faster trajectory to develop high blood pressure, to develop diabetes, to become obese, because their struggle to move forward in life is so arduous? So we need studies to really, you know, further document this so that we can really think about how to work with school teachers and principals and parents, you know, in order to make it easier, and policymakers, you know. And I'm just so delighted by what we are seeing in terms of the American Rescue Plan, the prospects of reducing child poverty among Black folks by 50%. You think about what that's going to do in terms of preventing some of these, you know, really very serious health problems that are a consequence of people being embedded in poverty and then trying to overcome those circumstances, you know, into which they were born. We need a lot more work on gender differences, neighborhood level effects, and we also need to make sure, you know, that that we're not overlooking something important in terms of mental health consequences. So I'm not going to say any more about this. I've already sort of briefly talked about some of the policy implications. Invest in people, invest in places, make it easier for people to be healthier. Everything that I know about John Henryism tells me that you would get a good return on investing in people, investing in children, investing in families, investing in neighborhoods. These people have a very strong work ethic, and that work ethic is very, very prevalent among working class Black Americans. Contrary to the cultural racism that describes Black Americans, working class Black folks as not being interested in working. You know, for me, that is just not true. and I think that, you know, I think that the work I've done and others have done really attests to that. There is a desire out there to be successful. No child comes into the world wanting to be a failure. Every child comes into the world wanting to be a success. And we have lots of evidence to demonstrate, you know, a good return on investments in early childhood education. It just pays off. Pays off for individuals, pays off for families, pays off for communities. It will pay off for the country as a whole. Okay, I thank you.
We do have a number of questions that have come in. And thank you very much for that informative talk. Your hypothesis, the John Henryism hypothesis, was motivated by a case study leading to epidemiologic research. Do you have other case studies that motivated your work?
No, this kept me pretty busy. You know, so it, in a way it was, you know, we talk about how physicians will sometimes see things in their practice, in their clinical practice, that gives them an idea that they will then, you know, I mean, if they themselves are trained as researchers, you know, and if they're based in an academic health center, they can actually write a grant themselves and test their hypothesis. So you have, you know, you have some pretty interesting and important research coming out of clinical observations. Well, my work on John Henryism came out of a, the questioner characterized it as a single case study, but it was a social observation, right? It was an encounter with someone who, whose life story just seemed to be so full of possibilities that I wondered if what was represented in his life was something that could be manifested on a population level, right? And finding a way to study that on a population level took a lot of work. It takes a lot of time. Now, do I have other oral histories that I've conducted with Black folks, working class and middle class, just to kind of get a sense of how much John Henryism am I hearing in their oral histories? Yes, I have conducted those kinds of oral histories. And they're rich in terms of information, and the book that I will write will draw upon that material.
Excellent. This is a question about the hypothesis in intergenerational health. Pregnant women with permanent stressors might be an altered physiological state that impacts fetal development and reprograms them for later onset adult diseases. Might this explain differences in the prevalence of gravid diseases, pregnancy outcomes, and altered child health?
Yes, I mean that is a great question, and I think the person who asked the question is probably very familiar with the literature bearing on this issue. Indeed, Black women, particularly working class Black women, who we have far more on their plates than they really should have on their plate, and in terms of taking care of children, their own and other people's children, taking care of aging parents, struggling to make ends meet, struggling to balance so many things. But when they get pregnant, they have to deal with a lot of stressors in their day to day life. One way that they deal with those stressors is just to keep pushing, keep working, in the vein that I call John Henryism. In the vein that, some other public health scholars, particularly African-American women, are beginning to call the superwoman schema, right? Being the superwoman. So it's basically, it's sort of the same thing. The same idea is that you just have to keep pushing. Well, against forces in the environment that are making it difficult for you to live the kind of life that you want to live and to provide for the next generation. Well, I think that those physiological mechanisms that I identified that connect high coping with accelerated risk for cardiovascular disease, increased heart rate, high levels of circulating stress hormones, cortisol. Well, when the mother is carrying that fetus is going to be bathed, flooded by those stress hormones. And that can certainly reprogram fetal development in ways that can put the newborn on a faster trajectory to develop, cardiometabolic diseases. So you get the intergenerational effects, and those babies are more often than not born into these very stressful environments, right? And they're already sort of programmed to respond to those stressful environments in a very intense way, because of the underlying biological programming. So yes, I do think, and so what we really are talking about is really an epigenetic phenomenon. It's not genes by themselves, it's not the environment by itself, but it's the interaction between genetic predisposition, epigenetic predisposition, and longer term disease risk. And I think that this is one of the important new frontiers for research.
Thank you for that. We have one last question, and I also wanted to put my email address out there in case people were having challenges submitting questions via the Qualtrics form. My email address is mtomp7@gmu.edu. Feel free to submit questions that way as well. So last question that we have right now, could repeated high effort coping explain health disparities in migrant populations in comparison to others?
Oh, what a lovely question. And what a good research question. Here's what we know. We know that, and I suspect that the questioner knows this, we know that immigrants to the US tend to have better health, right, than their co-ethnic or co-racial counterparts. Now you have, you know, lots of good plausible explanations for that, the healthy migrant effect, and the buffering hypothesis and so on. But we also know that with time, in the case of Mexican Americans, it takes about 10 years, you know, for that health advantage that we see, you know, in the early years of their arrival, it takes 10 to 15 years for that health advantage to disappear. Ollie and Geronimus, among others, you know, looked at how variations in allostatic load as a function of length of residence in the U.S. among Latinx populations using a national data set, right, the NHANES data set. And we see that with increasing length of stay in the U.S. among for Latinx populations, allostatic load scores increase. Well, that's wear and tear. You know, that's physiological wear and tear. And we know from, you know, evidence, being presented almost daily now about the disparate impact of the coronavirus on Hispanic populations, particularly, you know, New York and in LA. And it's because I would hypothesize these populations are caught up, in circumstances where they have to go to work. You know, obviously you have the crowded living conditions and so on, as a result of high rent and low income, low wages, and so they have to push themselves. They can't afford to stay at home and work. As better all people can do, they have to go out there. So their exposure, to the virus is so much greater. And if with having been born in the U.S. and having been subjected to similar kinds of forces of cultural racism and denigration that Black Americans have been subjected to, and then working hard to prove that those things are not true about you. that can take a toll. That can take a toll, and it can, it can interfere with people's ability to exercise and to eat healthily and to get sufficient rest and so on. And so they're going to be more overweight. You know, they're going to be more prone to diabetes. Some of them will have high blood pressure, right? So when the virus comes along, they're going to be more vulnerable than they would be if those circumstances were not in place. So I do think that there is a story here. I made the point not at the outset, but maybe halfway through my talk, that I don't see the John Henryism phenomenon as an African American specific phenomenon. I think it's telling us something about what it means to be human and to have aspirations, to live, to be successful in life, and the kinds of things that poor and working class Black people have to undergo, have to put up with, have to try to overcome in order to live their lives with dignity and to be successful. And I think that you see something similar in Europe. I mean, I really do. It's probably not as intense because the social safety nets in many European countries, particularly Western and Northern Europe, are stronger than they are in the United States, so that people don't have to resort just to what they can do for themselves to the same degree. And then once again, I would say this is the reason why the kinds of social safety nets that the current administration is beginning to put in place to give some protection for people, why that's so important for poor and working class people is just going to have, I think a tremendous payoff for the population, you know, 10, 15 years down the road, if we can make these policies permanent.
Thank you for that. And we appreciate your time very much. I'll turn it back to Jermaine to wrap us up. Thank you, Dr. James.
My pleasure.
On behalf of the College of Health and Human Services, thanks so much, Dr. James, for your great talk. Very motivational, very timely, as our college is working together to come together to decide how we're going to walk the talk in support of health equity moving forward. So thanks so much, and count on us for another invitation so you can actually come and see our campus and our beautiful building, amongst other things. So thank you.
I would love to do that. Thank you very much for the invitation.